Next talk is by Dr. Nihal Thomas. Sir, please come on to the stage. Dr. Nihal Thomas is already well known to most of the audience. He is a professor and head of endocrinology at CMC Velour. He is an avid researcher. He is a well-reputed teacher. He has pioneered many research projects, and he has many international publications to his credit, and he has authored many chapters in endocrine books. He will be talking on the topic of searching for MEN, that is multiple endocrine neoplasia in clinical practice. So we have different components of multiple endocrine neoplasia, and he will guide us which cases we should suspect and screen for multiple endocrine neoplasia. Sir, Professor Nihal Thomas, please.
Thank you. Thank you for that introduction, and it's been a pleasure to come for this very well-organized meeting and also be amongst speakers of real high credibility. Nalini, that was a wonderful talk, and thank you for that. I'm going to focus on one kind of multiple endocrine neoplasia, and that is multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1. Because of lack of time, I will focus largely on this particular disorder, and I'm going to be entirely case-based in my presentation. So you have basically a disorder which traditionally, as according to this cartoon, represents effect on the pituitary, the parathyroid, and the pancreatic islet. And I'll start with a little story. This is a 44-year-old gentleman who came in the year 2009. He came with pain in the hip and weakness. He also had erectile dysfunction. He was seen in Bangladesh and then referred to us, and his calciums were rather high and was diagnosed to have hyperparathyroidism. His prolactin levels were also elevated, very high, and he was started on cabergolin, and the prolactin came down to some extent. He was advised parathyroid surgery. So this is the imaging which was done outside before he came to us, and you can see a fairly large pituitary adenoma, which is just below the optic chiasm. He was operated for abdominal swellings about 10 years before with a lipoma. He had multiple cutaneous swellings all over the back and the front, told to have neurofibromas. His sisters, in fact, his brother had come about 9 years before and was my patient, had parathyroid disease as well. So on coming to Velour, he was found to have this pain in what was attributed towards an inguinal hernia. He also had dyspepsia for 10 years and was on omeprazole, and he was noted to have acral enlargement. In fact, interestingly, that was not really pointed out before he came to Velour. So he also had this tiredness early in the morning before taking a cup of tea, and was not documented to have hypoglycemia. So you can see over here, he's obviously acromegaloid. He's got thick lips, a fairly prominent nose, and you can see the supraorbital ridges are also quite prominent, and he's got macroblastia. He's got early hallux valgus in the big toes, as you can see as well. Now, these are the typical skin lesions which have been reported in Western literature as collagenomas, which have been seen in MEN1, and if you look and you see these, they can sometimes be much smaller and confluent with the skin, and therefore they're very misleading and maybe in fact ignored altogether. They are seen in about 80% according to Western literature, though in our experience it's much, much lower, maybe about 25% or so. This is his biochemical profile. As you can see, his fasting sugar was low, borderline low of 63 milligram per deciliter. Growth hormone levels were sky high with a high prolactin on cabergolin therapy. And he has a high calcium but a normal phosphate. And the growth hormone effect in physiology will actually raise the phosphate, opposing the effect of PTH over there. The PTH was high, and the alkaline phosphatase was also elevated, indicating an active metabolic bone disease. We did a 72-hour fast because his fasting sugar was 63. And within 8 hours, it went down to 39 milligram per deciliter, and the insulin levels were also elevated. So when you have a patient with MEN1, with this kind of a presentation, you really want to be sure that you catch all the fish in the net. And you use a test which is now used and also misused a lot for neuroendocrine tumors as well as malignancies. However, this is what we did. We did a fluorodeoxy PET scan. We also did a technetium systemibye scan. And that, as you can see, has localized a parathyroid adenoma on this side. You can see quite clearly that the bone is affected, and that is probably a brown tumor in the bone due to the hyperparathyroidism in the hip, not pain of a hernia. The CT on the PET has shown a very large Taylor pancreas tumor in addition, which is metabolically active. And the gastrin levels were 19,000, indicating that this tumor was producing gastrin. And maybe it's difficult to actually say which is producing what, but the smaller lesions might be producing insulin and the bigger ones producing gastrin. So the MRI shows a number of smaller lesions as well, possibly insulinomas, and therefore he has multiple tumors in the pancreas producing multiple different hormones. On the PET, you can also see that in the anterior mediastinum there's a lesion. So what would it be if it's an anterior mediastinal lesion in this situation? Thymic carcinoid. So here the thymus also has a tumor in addition. Remember, we're still dealing with one patient. And over here, in addition, as you can see, the CT of the abdomen in the PET shows another metabolically non-active lesion in the adrenal gland, and this is possibly an adrenal incidentalomas, which are more common, once again, in MEN1. It's a non-functioning adrenal adenoma. So this gentleman has a total of 9 lesions, an insulinoma, a gastrinoma, he has growth hormone and prolactin-producing tumor, parathyroid adenoma, carcinoid, non-functioning adrenal adenomas, collagenomas, and lipomas on the body. So this is a classical patient with MEN1. In fact, my PG said this is not MEN1 in a man. This is a man in MEN1 because he has so many tumors. So there's a very tight homeostasis over here, and it's a difficult management decision because the growth hormone per se is probably opposing the insulin action, and he's not getting as bad hypoglycemia because of the excessive amount of growth hormone. So no overt hypoglycemic episodes. At the same time, GH versus PTH, there is no hyper or hypophosphatemia, as you can see over here in addition. So we talked to him in detail. It looks simple from a surgical perspective. The surgeon will say, I will take off the pituitary. The endocrine surgeon will say, I will take off the pancreatic lesions. But there's a very delicate balance in homeostasis, which we should not disrupt. We may do more harm than good. Remember, he's been having vague symptoms for 11 years, but he's not outrightly sick, as said. We gave him octreotide and cabergolin, and he had worsening of hypoglycemic symptoms and was started on diazoxide, zoledronic acid for his hypercalcemia and osteoporosis. Biochemical values, so subsequently he did have a parathyroidectomy, which I will show. These are the sequential values because he did not want to have any surgical intervention on the first visit. And you can see the values subsequently, the growth hormone levels are still high after the octreotide treatment. IGF-1 levels are also elevated. So on follow-up, he was operated for the parathyroid disease. The PTH normalized. He had a 3.5 parathyroidectomy, and a small bit was kept in the sternomastoid. It was continued on this treatment, diazoxide for insulinoma, cabergolin for the prolactinoma, and octreotide for the growth hormone excess. You can see over here that there is a reasonable response to octreotide therapy. Remember, he was on cabergolin for a long time and the lesion had not shrunk, but after octreotide treatment, you can see that there is a reduction in the pituitary size, which is gratifying. You don't always get this kind of a response. Gastrin levels also came down with octreotide from 19,000 to 3,000. So octreotide is a somatostatin analog, basically, so it can block multiple hormone production. Right. So the plan, he subsequently had a transphenoidal surgery for pituitary adenoma. We are planning on a potential surgery for tail of the pancreas and surgery for the thymic carcinoid, where in MEN1, they very often are malignant tumors. So you can see the challenges over here is that it needs constant counseling at many points, a long follow-up, which needs multiple interventions, and therefore a lot of teamwork is also required. So MEN1 is a disorder which was described about 110 years ago, and in 1953 was the first case series of 8 patients with pituitary, parathyroid, and pancreatic tumors. It was called the Wormer syndrome thereafter in 1954 when he reported it to be possibly an autosomal dominant trait. And 1988, the MEN1 locus was identified in the gene. And I'm not going to talk anything about the genetics over here, but this is the last slide on genetics, which will show you that it's localized in chromosome 11 and is a tumor suppressor gene. There are more than 1,300 mutations reported to date, and therefore there are challenges in actually trying to use MEN1 diagnostic testing. In MEN2, as in medullary thyroid cancer and those who have the RET proto-oncogene, it's a different ballgame, which is much more specific and sensitive. In MEN1, very often you may not, depending on your diagnostic testing, it's not as useful. So the pathogenesis here is basically a two-hit hypothesis. Therefore, you first have a germline mutation and subsequently a post-zygotic phenomena, and therefore it's a two-hit disorder. Therefore, this is how it evolves. The components of MEN1 basically include a parathyroid, which is the most common tumor, pancreatic lesions, and subsequently pituitary lesions. And therefore, an absolute overlap between all three conditions, as you can see in the Venn diagram, is about 12% over here in the center, and various distributions of other permutations and combinations. This is an ancient description of an MEN1. This is a giant who is reported in Jewish, Christian, and Islamic literature by name Goliath. And a champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. His height was 6 cubits in a span. This is growth hormone excess. As the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly towards battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag, he took out a stone. The stone sunk into his forehead and he fell face down to the ground. So the attack was planned early in the morning. The giant had fasting hypoglycemia and possibly had an insulinoma. He could not see the stone coming. Therefore, he had bitemporal hemianopia, a pituitary adenoma. The stone penetrated the skull. He had hyperparathyroidism with fragile bones. And this is after he killed him, he cut off his head. This is the first intentional removal of a pituitary adenoma with a 100% cure rate for growth hormone excess. No neurosurgeon is this effective. The cure rates for growth hormone excess with the best neurosurgeon is still around 40 to 50% with pituitary macroadenomas with growth hormone excess. Right. The first patient operated for insulinoma was a surgeon, explored by Dr. William Mayo, as you know, of Mayo Clinic fame. Had neuroglycopenic symptoms with hallucinations, and he also had, incidentally, nephrolithiasis and weakness. Of course, he didn't put it together to think of a syndrome at that particular point of time. And he probably had acromegaly as well. So this is the kind of natural history of the disease, as you can see, between ages of presentation, starting in childhood. If you have a pituitary adenoma in someone less than the age of 20, that is very unusual. I mean, you should think of a syndromic association. Pituitary adenomas occur usually well past puberty, people in their 30s, 40s, 20s, okay. But less than 20, think of MEN1 as a possibility, maybe one of the earlier presentations. Parathyroid adenoma, of course, has a wide spectrum of presentations right across age groups. We had a patient with an insulinoma, a lady who presented at the age of 70 with hypoglycemia. And then we went back in the history and we found that she had renal stones about 40 years before. So that's the kind of thing it may actually come across many years. Now, the presentation, therefore, can be highly varied. One family with varied manifestations of MEN1 in 9 members. This is the pedigree of the family we have. Recurrent meningioma thrice, died of pancreatic cancer. Sisters, daughter, and 2 brothers and daughter also died at a young age due to cancer. The second patient, married to patient 1 by second degree consanguineous marriage, had a duodenal ulcer. Now we're coming to patient 7, who were patients who were really worked up well. 1998 bone pain, I had a parathyroidectomy subsequently done, a pituitary macroadenoma with a prolactin which is borderline high, was treated elsewhere with cabergolin, and a genetic testing which ultimately was shown positive. So here is the pituitary adenoma that you can see over here going into the optic chiasm, and that's the sagittal view once again. In 2011, was found to have elevated chromoglandin and came with occasional hypoglycemic symptoms. And the CT and the MRI abdomen showed multiple ill-defined lesions in the pancreas. As you can see, very large lesions in the pancreas. Patient underwent a 72-hour fast. The sugars dropped, but we had these very strange insulin values. And sometimes these tumors may produce a pro-hormone in large quantities, which may not react with the insulin assay. So pro-insulin levels were probably very high. We have never really proven this. But ultimately, he did have a lesion which was producing this at the same time. He He underwent distal pancreatectomy and enucleation of the pancreatic head lesion and is on insulin for control of hyperglycemia. So subsequent to that, because it's a large lesion, there was some compromise of the islet cell mass and he's developed diabetes. This does not usually happen with most insulinoma surgeries. The lesions are enucleated well and patients do well after that without developing diabetes. Here is another one, patient 6 in the same family, and prolactinoma with apoplexy in, as a history of a duodenal ulcer with high gastrin levels, and also had a parathyroid tumor, localized parathyroid adenoma, had a history of osteoporosis on the DEXA scan. So that is a technetium systemobile scan, and this is the initial scan, and then you do a washout of the isotope, and you can see over here the lesion is present. Right? An ectopic lesion down here. So the patient had a 3.5 parathyroidectomy and a cervical thymectomy. If you're thinking of MEN1 and you're going into the thorax, you generally tend to take off the thymus because the chance of a thymic carcinoid developing at some point of time is very high. Post-op hypoparathyroidism on calcium and vitamin D replacement. This is the thymic mass. Again, you can see the thymic mass over here. And it was found to be malignant, as expected. Therefore, he had multiple courses of cisplatin and etoposide, and followed by radiation treatment as well. And that is the rest, can show you a nice clearance of the tumor, even though it was a malignancy after all the treatment. Another sibling found an SOL in the left lower lobe of the lung and had a suspected carcinoid at another center. But the histopathology sent to us showed a chondroid hamartoma, so other tumors can also occur. Over here, another patient, headache, cabergolin, treatment for a prolactinoma, as you can see over here. Remember, they're all part of the same family members. Also had a lipoma in the suprasternal notch. And patient number 9, the son of patient number 5, comes with multiple collagenomas. Once again, these are lesions which have to be looked at. If they're very small, they're very subtle, but these are much more obvious. High normal serum calcium and is planned for parathyroid surgery. So one family with varied manifestations of MEN1 in 9 members. So how do we screen for MEN1? If the age to begin testing, if you have a pedigree or a family, is at 5 years, you check prolactin, IGF-1, do an MRI, periodically every 3 to 5 years. Insulinomas, again, can develop hypoglycemia at a very young age. Parathyroid tumors at around the 8 years of age. Foregut carcinoids, gastrinomas, and endopancreatic tumors. So you can see the imaging protocols and the biochemical workup that is required. In our experience, we have a set of 28 subjects with 18 families over the last decade or so. And a family history of MEN1 was definite in 12 subjects and doubtful in 5 of these families. You can see over here that a pituitary tumor was present in 45%, similar to the international percentages reported in other literature of around 40% or so. And you can have very small tumors right up to very large tumors, which are very invasive. Our parathyroid series in the MEN1, of course, parathyroid disease is very common. Once again, 90%, which is 24 out of 28, and some of it is represented in this particular article over here. They do have milder parathyroid disease when compared to most of the Indian parathyroid disease that we see. So you can see over here, the calciums are 12.5, and my colleagues will also tell you that we see much more severe parathyroid disease than this. So the range is very different for the MEN1 patients that we see. Systemobile scan once again over here showing you, and a superimposition SPECT scan confirming deletion. Pancreatic tumors in about half, and gastrinomas were a dominant number in 6. Insulinomas at 7 out of 13, somewhere discovered in this particular article as well. But the range, as you can see, can start from very young, around 23, up to 71 years of age. So here, insulinomas with, in the pancreas, multiple lesions. Again, multiple lesions on the pancreas. Adrenal enlargement is also seen in 1/3 of these patients. And Cushing's was reported, one of these adrenal tumors was functional. You can have malignancies in these adrenal lesions very, very rarely. Thymic carcinoids in some, bronchial carcinoids in a few. And as I mentioned, the Indian experience, cholangiomas is actually uncommon. It's only 3 out of the 28. We looked for them systematically. A very small percentage have skin lesions, and they are not good markers for MEN1 in Indian patients. Okay, so in summary, MEN1 is a disorder characterized by a number of neoplasms, both endocrine and non-endocrine, a strong history, pedigree charting, and a thorough physical examination is required, not to mention a very, very thorough follow-up at least every 6 months. Periodic radiological screening coupled with aggressive surgical intervention are necessitated. Therapy has to be customized and individualized. So you have to look at the patient as a whole, and therefore, even if you have multiple tumors, decide whether operating all of them is really necessary or good for the patient. I'd like to acknowledge our team over here, Dr. Simon, who's in particularly focusing on pituitary disease, Asha on MEN1 series per se, Thomas on metabolic bone disease, the surgical endocrine team, the neurosurgical team, and the biochemistry department in addition. Thank you for your patience. Just one slightly commercial announcement is that the organizing chairman, Dr. Thomas Paul, who was here yesterday, just wanted me to put up a slide, and that the ISBMR is going to be in Velo next year in October 2015. That's the National Osteoporosis Conference, and we invite all of you to attend this. Thank you for your patience. Thank you.